Today, let's talk about the partial loss of prestress. Okay. The partial loss of prestress is the reduction of prestressing force in the tendon. Okay, and that must be considered carefully, because if you have the initial prestress and it's reduced with time, you need a correct approximation in order to confirm that your structure will behave properly, both at initial condition during the construction and at the service condition, which can be probably several months or few years after that. All right. The loss of prestress can be categorized into two groups. Okay. The first one is called immediate loss of prestress. The immediate loss of prestress actually occur when you try to put the prestressing force in. Okay, so actually the initial prestressing force, PI, is the result after you face all of this immediate loss of prestress already. Okay, in order to obtain the desirable PI, initial prestressing force, okay, you will need to put additional force in to compensate with this immediate loss, and that is called jacking force, okay, PJ, the force that you will need to really put it. All right, there are three main components of the immediate loss of prestress. Okay, the first one is friction. Okay, I will explain in details later. The second one is anchorage slip or anchorage sitting. All right, and the last one is elastic shortening of the concrete. Okay, if you have a lot of this one, then you need to put the jacking force more in order to obtain the initial force. All right. Another group of loss of prestress is called time-dependent loss of prestress. Okay, and this does not occur immediately during the construction. This will occur gradually after you already install the system. Okay, when you install the system, you will get initial prestressing force, PI. Okay, and after that, when time goes by, the prestressing force will reduce, and there are three main reasons that the prestressing force is reduced. The first one is the shrinkage of the concrete. Okay, when the concrete shrinks, okay, the length is reduced, and when the length of the concrete reduced, then the tendon will also be shortened as well, resulting in some reduction of the prestressing force. The second one is creep of the concrete. Okay, and the last one is relaxation of the steels. Okay, these three combined together, okay, give us some reduction during the service or the usage of the structure after construction. Okay, when you install initial prestressing force and the system is subjected to this group of loss, okay, finally you will get in the design we call effective prestress. Okay, the difference between PEI and PE is therefore the time-dependent loss of prestress. Okay, and we need to calculate this. Okay, if you remember in the flexural design, okay, we use effectiveness ratio R in order to represent the difference between effective prestress and initial prestress. Okay, R must be always less than 1, because effective prestress cannot be larger than initial prestress. And actually in this case, R represents the time-dependent loss. Okay, time-dependent loss of the prestress. Okay, there are several approaches for us to approximate or calculate the loss of prestress. Okay, the simplest one, okay, is what we call lump sum approximation. What we call lump sum approximation is that we don't go into details, but we calculate by experience. Okay, so we don't need to go into the detailed calculation, but we just put that, okay, for this type of the structure, the loss should be this much. For example, if you are designing the floor, post-tension floor, okay, post-tension floor normally will have very similar configuration, span length and also the depth of the floor. In that case, even if you make the detailed calculation, you will finally get similar value for almost all floor structures. In those cases, no meaning to make the detailed calculations. Okay, the lump sum approximation will be more practical because it saves time and it will always be satisfying, safe enough. All right. Another category is what we call details calculation. Okay, when we do the detailed calculation or detailed estimation, we are meaning that we calculate the loss, okay, one by one. Now we have six components, okay, three is immediate loss, another three is time dependent loss. We will calculate each of them one by one and sum it together, and you will have the idea how much is the loss. Okay, this is the acceptable accurate. Okay, and for more complicated system, for example, if you are designing some special type of the bridge, okay, probably you select this one. Okay, but this one is not the best approximation because in this one, you did not consider that the loss of prestress affect also the loss of prestress. What does it mean? It means that when you calculate each component, you will need to put in some pre-stressing force. Okay, the loss of pre-stress will be higher or lower depend on the magnitude of force itself. Okay, in the calculation here, we will assume that the force is constant and estimate, but in reality, it is not. Because if you consider the time-dependent loss, time-dependent loss will lost by creep as well. Okay, and time-dependent loss will also lost by the steel relaxation as well. By these two reasons, the pre-stressing force is reduced with time. So actually, the real loss of pre-stress will be less than the value that you can get, okay, in the case that you put some constant value. Okay, if you want more precise estimation, okay, you will need to consider the coupling effect between these two. Okay, and the most convenient way for you to estimate this is that you calculate the remaining pre-stressing force in each time step. For example, if you want to calculate the loss of pre-stress at actually 10 years, okay, in this detailed estimation, you just calculate it just one time during 10 years. Okay, but for this, you will separate it into probably first month, first year, 5 years, and then 10 years. After that, you calculate the remaining pre-stressing force at the end of each period and use that value as the initial force of the next period. You will get better approximation. So this one will be more time consuming, okay, but give you more realistic estimation. So this one will be required only when the system seems to be really complicated. You have some special configuration or the structure is really, really big, okay, and unique, so that you don't have confidence that you can just use the normal calculation method. All right. Okay. The reason that we need to calculate the loss of pre-stress is that if you don't approximate it very carefully, you probably put too much or too low checking force. Okay, or you may put too much or too low R effective ratio in your calculation. This will actually disturb the service condition. Okay, normally if you make the miscalculation in the loss of pre-stress, there will be very little effect on the ultimate capacity, okay, of the structures. But if you make a misestimation, okay, it will affect a lot the behavior of structures during the service condition. For example, if you put too much R in the calculation and the real R is less, pre-stressing force will remain in the structure and your structure probably camber up, okay, for all period of time. And due to the creep, the camber up will increase gradually, and that probably become problems. Okay, so we need really, really good approximation so that this type of problem will not take place. Alright, now let's go into detail one by one. How can we estimate each component of the friction loss? Start from immediate loss. We have three, okay, friction, anchorage slip, okay, sometimes called anchorage sitting and the elastic shortening. And another group is time-dependent loss of stress, composed of concrete shrinkage, creep of concrete, and relaxation. Okay. The first one, okay, loss of stress due to friction, is actually occur, okay, because when you put the prestressing tendon in, okay, the prestressing tendon will touch with some materials. Most probably, it will touch with the duct. Okay, and when you pull the prestressing force, okay, the tendon will try to move in the same direction with the force. Okay, there will always be the friction acting in opposite direction. And because of that, the force in the tendon is not constant along the span. Okay, at the end of the member, you will get maximum value of the force. Okay, and at far distance from the support, you will get less and less value. Okay, the reduction of this prestressing force depends on two mechanisms. The first one is what we call wobble friction. Wobble friction is what we say like a randomness of the tendon. You want to put it in this shape, but normally it will not be like that. There will be some variation. And the variation will create unexpected loss of stress. Okay, normally this will be estimated by one coefficient which is obtained from the manufacturers of the tendon. Okay, it will be given, and this one we call K, wobble friction coefficient. Okay, the reduction of prestress DP, okay, is linearly related to this wobble friction coefficient. Okay, so if you know the wobble friction coefficient and then you multiply it with prestressing force in your case, okay, and the distance of the tendon, then you get the loss of prestress at that location due to wobble effect. Okay, the second effect is the curvature friction. Okay, curvature friction occur because normally when you put the tendon will not be straight. Okay, especially in the post tension. Okay, you know really well, because if we put it a kind of parabola, you get balancing force. Okay, you will get the straight tendon only when you use the precast, okay, system. All right. If the direction of the tendon change, okay, if the direction of the tendon change, you will get some vertical force acting between tendon. Okay, between tendon and the duct. Okay, now let's assume that you have the member and there is parabolic shape of the tendon. And if we select, or if we consider just one portion, okay, of the member here. All right, and we consider the small portion of the tendon here. You will see that the tendon actually has the loss of prestress equal to DP, okay, in this length, okay, and the direction of the force slightly changed due to the tendon profile. Okay, if you calculate the difference of the force in order for this one to be in equilibrium, okay, it's really clear that you will have another force acting between the duct and the tendon. The duct have to put the tendon down, and the tendon lift the duct down. The force that the tendon lift the duct, the tendon will lift the duct up, okay? And the force that tendon lift the duct up is actually related to the equivalent force, equivalent load, all right? This can be calculated based on the change of the angles. Okay, if you have a lot of change of the angle, the magnitude here will be large. If the change of the angle is really small, then the magnitude here will be really small. Okay, and you can see that we put the force P here, okay, in both direction, because at the calculation we assume that the difference here is negligible. Okay, so you get this one. Okay, finally, after make approximation, okay, some basic assumption to simplify the calculation, then you will get this equation. All right. Okay. Normally, when you design, okay, the friction coefficient, either wobble friction coefficient or curvature coefficient will be given from the manufacturers. Okay, most of the time it will be given in term of length. Okay, normally you may select the middle value, okay, or you can just select any appropriate value in the length. Okay, this is the responsibility of the designers to do so. All right. Once you know the value of the coefficient k and mu given from the manufacturers, okay, we can calculate the loss of prestress due to friction at any location along the span. Okay, if you put the prestressing force at the end, okay, you can calculate how much force remaining, okay, at each location. Okay, by just integrate the loss of prestress, okay, from the point of jacking along the span up to that point. Very simple. And we do that by doing integration. Okay, starting from the loss of prestress at the point of interest to the jacking force. Okay, you will get this equation. Alright, and after that, after you do this integration, then you will get this exponential equation. Okay, exponential equations. Okay, so actually, if your system has really constant value of k and mu, the prestressing force will vary as the exponential value, exponential graph. All right, okay. But we found that this one sometimes is too complicated to estimate. All right, so we try to make some simplification. Okay, we simplify the answer by put two assumptions in. The first one, we assume that in the calculation of loss, we can just consider that the prestressing force at all location is same. Okay, and use value P. Okay, actually it is not same. In the exact calculation previously, we consider that the prestressing force is varying. Okay, because in the real case it's varying, you have friction loss. Okay, but in order to simplify it, we assume that it is same. And you can just use PI at this value. Okay, so if you simplify the system like that, okay, and you also simplify that the curvature of the tendon is same everywhere along the span, then you can simplify the system into this. Okay, you will get not exponential anymore. You will get the linear relationship. Okay, between jacking force and the force at any location x. All right. After doing the simplification, the graph, okay, between the force in the tendon and the distance from the jacking location will be linear. Okay, this make the calculation much more simple. Okay, and you can calculate it much faster. Okay, all right. However, this simplification can be applied only if the coefficient, okay, this one is wobble coefficient with L. L is the distance from the jacking location to the location that you consider, okay, and friction curvature friction coefficient, and the curvature is less than 0.3. Okay, if this value is higher than 0.3, we found that the simplified equation is not accurate enough. You need to go back and use the exact calculation method. Okay, you cannot assume that the prestressing force constant along the span. Okay, because the loss of prestress seem to be too much. Okay, for that assumption. All right. Okay, so this is the comparison between the exact equation and the approximation. Okay, and normally in the approximation, you will need to determine how much will be the change of the curvatures. Okay, we can use this equation to calculate the curvatures. Okay, normally in their case, you probably get parabolic profiles because parabolic profile will compensate with the uniform force acting on the structures. But in this one, when we put the assumption that the curvature is constant along the span, it means that we don't consider our curve as parabola in this calculation. We consider it as the part of the circle. So you have the same curvature along the line. Okay, and with that, you can approximate the change of the angles by this equation. Okay, where y is the sagging at the middles, okay, of the tendon, and x is the direction, I mean the length of the tendon. All right, okay. Okay, that is all for the first immediate loss of heat stress, the friction. Okay, but that is not the only one. Okay, we have the next loss of heat stress. Okay, the next loss of heat stress occur when you already pull the tendon. Okay, when you pull the tendon, friction loss take place. Okay, but when after that, when you release the some part of tendon will try to returning. Okay, and the force will just transfer from the jacking system to the structure itself. Okay, during this process, the gap between the apparatus, pre-stressing apparatus, okay, and the structure itself will be closed. Okay, when it is closed, the tendon itself becomes shortened. And that shortening affects the pre-stressing force in some location of the member. Okay, we will need to quantify how much pre-stressing force reduces at any location. Alright, actually there are several approaches. Okay, today I will just give you two examples. The first one, okay, most useful in the case that you have quite short member. Alright, this is the approximation by assume that when you release the force and you have some shortening, the shortening is distributed uniformly along the span. For example, if you have 10 meter length structure and the seating has 10 millimeter. Now we are assume that 1 millimeter displacement is occur per 1 meter and that occur uniformly. Alright, by assume like that, it means that the strain loss in the materials is uniform everywhere. Okay, and if the strain loss is uniform everywhere, it means that the loss of heat stress will be same everywhere. Okay, so if we consider the blue line occurring after friction loss and the green line, okay, which is the resultant pre-stressing force after anchorage seating, okay, it will be parallels. It will be parallels. Okay, this will obtain only when you assume that the shortening displacement distribute uniformly. Okay, all right. This is one method that you can use to approximate. Alright, if the critical section is at the middle, then you use the value here to check. Normally, if you design the flexural member, okay, let's say the simply supported one, okay, the critical section will be at the middle. Okay, so you will consider the loss of heat stress at the middle. Okay, but this one is not realistic actually. It's fast, okay, most of the time it will give you more estimation or conservative side of the value. Okay, you get more loss of heat stress than reality, but it's not realistic. It is not realistic because in reality the displacement will not be uniform. I mean the distribution of displacement will not be uniform because you have friction. Okay, you have friction. In the case that you release the force, when you pull the tendon, okay, during the pulling, okay, the friction will acting in opposite direction with the jacking force. After that, if you release, the tendon will try to move back. Okay, now friction will try to change the direction at the same. Okay, if at that moment pre-stressing force is not changing, Okay, the magnitude will be same, but the direction of friction will change. Okay, this phenomenon we call reverse friction. Reverse friction. And if we consider by assuming that the magnitude of force is not changed yet, okay, the curve that you get, okay, first during the jacking, the pre-stressing force will resist the movement due to jacking. After that, when you release, okay, the jacking force will at this part, okay, will become opposite. Okay, the remaining probably become same if the portion of the tendon here does not move at all, remain the same. All right. Okay, if you get something like this, okay, the reverse friction will occur in this zone. Okay, and the pre-stress drop or loss of pre-stress due to ankylosing sitting will occur only in the region that you get reverse friction. Okay, we can demonstrate like this. If the blue line is the line that you get from pre-stressing after friction loss, okay, and then you put the ankylosing sitting in, all right, this portion will drop. Okay. Okay, and there will be one point that there is no slip occurring anymore. Okay, so the friction will not change. And beyond that point, friction will not change at all. Alright, so beyond that point, the curve will remain same even after ankylosing sitting. The major change will be on this. Okay, if we assume that before release of the jacking force and after release of the jacking force, the force here and here is same, the slope here and here will have same magnitude, just that you have negative and become positive later. All right, the area here actually give you the idea of the ankylosing sitting displacement. All right, so from the ankylosing sitting displacement, okay, you can actually calculate what will be the distance that get disturbed by the ankylosing sitting. Okay, from the equation. Okay, from the equation. So if you use this equation, okay, delta L is the ankylosing sitting distance, and you can obtain that from the system that you select. Okay, the other one you already get from the system, K mu, okay, is wobble friction coefficient, mu is curvature friction coefficient, you obtain from the previous section already. Alright, so you know everything. Okay, this one obtained from catalog. Okay, after that you can calculate LZ. So from this concept, you can calculate how far the tendon will be disturbed by the ankylosing sitting. Okay, all right. If the distance that tendon is disturbed by the ankylosing sitting is less than L over 2, you can say that, okay, at this location, there is no loss of pre-stress due to ankylosing sitting. Okay, but if this point is beyond the middle, you need to calculate how much is the loss of pre-stress at critical section. Okay, in the case of simply supported flexural member, it will be at the midspan, so you can calculate that. All right, okay. Mm-hmm. So depend on the system. Okay, most of the system, okay, the loss of pre-stress will be limited, okay, will be limited, because in most of the pre-stressing system, they will try to limit delta L here, the displacement, to be very small. Normally, it will be from 3 to 8 millimeters, okay, not longer than that. And in most of the time, the area that will be affected by this ankylosing loss will not be much, okay, will be really, really small, all right? Okay, the third component of the immediate loss of pre-stress, okay, the third component of the immediate loss of pre-stress is what we call elastic shortening of the concrete. Okay, this loss of pre-stress is really straightforward. You have the tendon, you put the concrete into compression. Concrete will have compressive deformation. It will shorten a little bit. When the concrete shorten, the tendon itself will become shortened as well. And if the tendon itself become shortened, it means that the force reduced as well. All right, and the reduction of force due to this mechanism is called elastic shortening of the concrete. Okay, the calculation due to this, I mean the calculation of loss of stress due to this reason is very, very simple. First, you will need to determine the stress of concrete at the location of tendon. Okay, if you can calculate the stress of concrete, okay, at the location of tendon, you divide it by Young modulus of concrete, you will get the strain that it concrete shrink. Okay, that is become shortened. After that, you multiply with Young modulus of pre-stressing tendon. You can calculate how much stress in the tendon is lost. Okay, if you want to change from the stress into the force, then you multiply the area of the tendon. Okay, by that system, we can just express this behavior just as the modular ratio n equal to EP over EC and multiply FCS. FCS is the stress of concrete at the location of the pre-stressing tendon that you are consider. Alright, very straightforward. Alright, but anyway, there are some caution that you need to consider. Okay, the first one, okay, for the pretension members, okay, you can calculate this, but you need to consider the self-weight as well. Let's consider the case of pretension, and you put constant eccentricity. All right, when you put the eccentricity in, of course, concrete will be shortened because of pre-stress, but you need to consider whether during that moment, that instant, okay, is there any external load applied at the same moment or not? If there is the moment due to the load applied, in this case is moment due to self weight applied, you need to consider that the shortening, okay, will be compensated by this deformation as well. Okay, and this normally occur in case of pretension member. In the case of pretension member, normally you put constant eccentricity. The tendon will be stretched, you pull it, you cast the concrete, and then you release the force. When you release the force, actually, concrete will bend like this due to pre-stressing. Okay, but there will be the self-weight applied as well, so it become like this. Okay, so it become like this, you need to consider this one as well at that moment. Okay, so the loss of pre-stress due to elastic shortening, okay, will not become because of pre-stress only, but due to the load that apply at that moment. Alright, this is the case for pre-tension. Okay, for the case of post-tension, okay, the caution is that normally in the post-tension, okay, when you pull the force due to jacking, you already put the compression force in the concrete. Okay, so the concrete will be under compression even before you release the force. When you put the force in or you release the jacking system, okay, for the first tendon, there will be no loss due to elastic shortening. Okay, for examples, if you want to get 100 ton PI and you know immediate loss, you estimate and then you pull first, probably you pull for 110 ton. Okay, your concrete will at that moment will be under compression for 110 ton. Okay, after that, when you release, concrete will actually swell a little bit and pre-stressing force will also reduce from PJ to PI, but it will compensate. In that condition, you don't have any elastic shortening loss at all. Okay, so if you have the post-tension member and we pull all tendon at the same time, okay, using the balance, I mean counterbalance into the concrete segment. Okay, in that case, we will consider that there is no elastic shortening lost, okay, right? The in the post-tension concrete, okay, you will get the elastic shortening loss of prestress only when you make the sequence pulling. For example, you probably have 10 tendon. You pull 5 tendon first, okay, and then you release the force. This 5 tendon will not suffer from the elastic shortening. But when you pull another 5, when you pull another 5, you put the compression force in the member. The first 5 tendon will become shortened. Okay, so the pulling of the later set of the tendon will affect the former set. Okay, in this case, you will need to consider how much the pulling of the next set of the tendon affect the former set of the tendon. All right, as the step. All right, okay. Okay, so that will be all. Okay, some caution is that normally when you check, okay, we will normally calculate the loss at the maximum moment section, or that is what we call critical section. All right, we will not consider everywhere because that will be time consuming. Okay, and in the case that you have some unbound system is mean that the tendon in rebar and concrete at that location probably not same because it is not bond. Okay, the compatibility will be linked by the displacement at the end. Okay, in that case, if you want to calculate the elastic shortening for unbound system, you need to calculate one by one at this one, and then combine the shortening along the span. Okay, you cannot use the equation that we explained in 2 previous slides. All right. Okay, that will be all for the immediate loss of prestress. Okay, all right. Thank you. Let's cut it here first. Okay, now you can. Okay, the next we will talk about time dependent loss of prestress. I remind you again that for the time dependent loss of prestress, we have 3 components as well. The first one is shrinkage of concrete. Second one is the loss due to creep of concrete. And the last one is the loss due to relaxation of the tendon. Okay. Let's talk about the concrete shrinkage first. Now, I believe that all of you know that the concrete will suffer from the shrinkage, probably due to the moisture loss, okay, or due to some chemical reaction inside itself. All right. When the concrete shrink, it means that the length of the concrete will reduce. Even without any load. If that shrinkage take place after you already install the pre-stressing system, what happened is that the tendon will also shorten and you will get the loss of pre-stress due to the concrete shrinkage. Okay? In order to calculate the loss of pre-stress due to shrinkage, okay, we will need to know how much concrete shrink after we apply the pre-stressing force. Okay, remember that the shrinkage of concrete before you install the pre-stressing system will not create any loss of pre-stress. Okay, because loss of pre-stress after will occur only after you put the tendon. So even if you have very high concrete shrinkage before that, okay, that will not be a problem. Okay, the calculation is very simple. If you have the concrete shrinkage after you apply the initial prestress, okay, and you just multiply it to the Young modulus of the tendon, you will get the loss of prestress, okay, in terms of the stress, okay, in the unit of the stress of the tendon, okay, and when we try to calculate the loss of prestress due to shrinkage, the time that you apply prestressing is really important. You need to know the age of the concrete at that pre-stressing. Okay. Normally for the pretension, we will put the pre-stressing force at around 1 day, 24 hours. Okay. For the post-tension, it will vary more. It can be 3 days. It can be 7 days in the case that you cast the concrete on site. Okay. For the segmental block girder, maybe you cast the concrete for several months already, and then you just compose it on the site. In that case, you will need to estimate the shrinkage only after the installation of prestress. Okay. All right. The calculation is very simple. Okay. Some code, for example, ACI 209. Okay. Give some guideline. How will you be able to calculate the shrinkage? Okay. By giving the easy equation. Okay. They say that in the design of prestressing tendon, we can just consider the shrinkage of concrete at any age. Okay, at any age. Okay, as the ultimate shrinkage of that concrete, multiply with the time function. Okay, time function is some function that is the function of age of the concrete. Okay, they also give the value that in the case that you use the concrete cure under moist condition. Okay, the ultimate shrinkage epsilon HHU here will be 800 micron. I mean micro. Okay, micro. 800 times 10 to the minus 6. In the case that you use the steam curing, okay, the ultimate shrinkage will be less. It will become 730 micro. Okay, alright. The time function is also given. Okay, for the moist keel, we use this time function. T over 35 plus 3 epsilon SHU. Okay, and for steam curing, we use T over 55 plus 3 epsilon SHU. Okay, another point that you need to consider is that now, if you use this value and this equation, we will consider T. Okay, between, I mean, which is larger than 7 days. Okay, why this value? Because they have data of the concrete beyond 7 days only. Normally, when we provide moist curing, we will cure it for 7 days. Okay, when you use the steam curing, normally we construct faster. Okay, and they have the data that probably you just cure it for 1 day and then you apply. Okay, so this function will be applicable for any time t more than 1. And this one is applicable for any time t more than 7. Okay, in order for you to calculate the loss of prestress with this equation. For examples, if you want to calculate the shrinkage at 1 year. Okay, and you put the prestressing force at 7 days. Okay, you will need to put the time function of with the 3 equal to 365, okay, 365 days is 1 year. You will get one value of time function. And you need to calculate the time function at 7 days. Okay, the difference will give you how much proportion of this, okay, will cause the loss of prestress. Okay, and then you can calculate, okay, the loss of prestress by the former equation. Very simple, very simple. Okay, there is another guideline offering by PCI. PCI is the Prestress Concrete Institute, okay, also based in US. Okay, they give different approach, okay. They say that the ultimate shrinkage can be calculated from this equation. Okay, it means that if you get the standard relative humidity and V over S ratio is the volume per surface of the structures. The shrinkage will be equal to 550 micro. Okay, but if you have different shape, okay, you will get different value. Okay, for example, if you get thinner member or smaller member, you will get larger volume. I mean, larger surface per volume. Okay, when your member is smaller, okay, the volume will be reducing in the faster rate. Okay, so for the smaller one, you get higher V over S ratio. Okay, for the larger one, you get less V over S ratio. Okay, all right, you put into this one. Okay, it means that if you have more V over S ratio, okay, you get less shrinkage. Larger structure get less shrinkage, get less shrinkage. If you have more relative humidity, okay, you also get less shrinkage. Okay, because evaporation will be slower. All right, okay, this is the basic ultimate shrinkage that they propose. Okay, now is the time factors. Okay, in case of ACI in previous slide, they offer the equation and we call time function. But now in the PCI approach, they give us the value at different day. Okay, and they call time factor. What is this time factor? Time factor can be calculated as KSH. KSH is the remaining portion of the shrinkage that can occur after that age. For example, if you make the concrete and then you put the pre-stressing force at 1 day. Okay, we will have a look at this table and have a look at the first column 1. Okay, you get 0.92. This means that after pre-stressing, you will suffer 92% of this shrinkage after you pre-stressing. Okay, but if you wait until 7 days and then you put the pre-stressing, we will come here and then we have 0.77. It means that approximately 23% of shrinkage already take place. If you pre-stress at 7 days, your pre-stressed concrete structure will suffer from only 70% of this ultimate shrinkage. Okay, all right. So this one will give you, okay, how much shrinkage remain to suffer your structure. I mean to make the loss of pre-stress in your structure after that. Okay, so with this factor, okay, we can just apply this one to this one, okay, and change the strain into the stress by multiplying Young modulus of pre-stressing tendon. Okay, so we combine this, okay, and we get this equation. Okay, note that V over S must be calculated in the unit of meter. Okay, V is volume in cubic meter. S is surface area in unit of square meters. Okay, RH is relative humidity. Alright, so it should be somewhere between 0 and 1. Relative humidity cannot be 102 or something like that. Okay, must be always less than. Okay, the second factor of time dependent loss is the creep. Okay, the big difference between creep and shrinkage is that if concrete does not resist any force, it will not creep. Okay, it will shrink, but it will not creep. Creep is deformation of the concrete. Okay, when it's subject to the stress. Okay, in order for you to understand the creep more clearly, we need to classify the deformation into instantaneous deformation. When you apply the force, okay, the deformation occurs immediately. Okay, that is the stress divided by Young modulus. Okay, what you study in all solid mechanics class. Okay, but as the concrete composed of some water molecules, okay, when you put the force in, water molecule will try to move and you get continuous gradual deformation. Okay, that is the creep. Okay, the creep of concrete depends on many things and we cannot make exact calculation. But what we know so far is we know that if you put more force, you will get more instantaneous or immediate deformation. And you get also more creep deformation. Okay, for the same type of concrete, we found that the ratio between creep strain and immediate strain seem to be one value for one specific type of concrete. For normal strength concrete, it will be one value. For high strength concrete, it will also be one value. Okay, but this ratio, the time dependent due to creep, okay, and also the elastic strain immediate strain, the ratio here will be one value for one type of concrete. Okay, this value Cu, okay, is called ultimate creep coefficient. Okay, this means that if this value is given, if you know this value, okay, and you can determine this one, okay, this one can be determined really easily because if you know the stress, you just divided it by EC at that time. Okay, use the stress divided by Young modulus, you get this one. And if you know this value, you can calculate the creep strain. Okay, creep strain. Okay, so with this knowledge, we just simplify the process of design. Now we want to estimate the loss of prestress due to creep. Okay, so we will just select the suitable length of Cu. Okay, normally the length of Cu, the ultimate creep coefficient will be in the length of 1.6 to 3.2. Okay, depends on the mixed proportion. Depends on the mixed proportion. Normally, high strength concrete will have less value. Less value. So now you have a freedom as designer. If you know that your concrete has very high strength, you may refer to some data, either research data or practical data, and probably select lower value. If you use the concrete which have a little bit higher water cement ratio or lower strength, you may select higher value. Okay, but normally in the design, we will just put value approximately 2.3 or 2.4 for this Cu. Okay, for this Cu. Okay. We also have another term, okay, we call epsilon Cu, okay. Actually, it's the same thing. It's the same thing, just that this one specific creep, okay, is another parameter that we can use, okay, instead of ultimate creep coefficient. The same thing is this one. Okay, now you get this one, epsilon Ci. Actually equal to FCI, this one is stress in concrete, divided by EC. Okay, so if you put Cu and then you divide it by Young modulus of concrete at that time, you will get the specific creep. Okay, actually specific creep and ultimate creep coefficient is strongly related by the Young modulus of concrete. Okay, and this table show you the typical value of specific creep and creep coefficient. Okay, lower strength of the concrete and then you have higher value. Okay, for the higher strength of the concrete, you get lower value. Okay, the length of the concrete that we normally use will be in this length, around 40 or 50 MPa. So normally in the design, we will put the value around 2.3 to 2.4, okay, in order to get the reasonable loss of prestress due to creep. Okay, and now because you can estimate the creep strain, okay, when concrete have the creep, it means that the force is constant and then it's reduced in length. When the concrete reduced in length, the tendon will also shorten with the same magnitude. Okay, so the loss of stress can be just calculated, okay, by using the creep coefficient multiplied with the stress at that time, okay, and then multiply with Young modulus of prestressing tendon, then you will get the loss of prestress due to creep. Okay, due to creep at that condition. Okay, this one is in terms of the stress. All right, okay. So quite simple, okay. Another note is that if you have relative humidity greater than 40%, okay, normally if you have more relative humidity, you will get less creep. Okay, if you have relative humidity less than 40, you can use this 2.35 for general concrete. Okay, but if the relative humidity that your structure will experience is higher than 40%, okay, you will need to calculate this factor. Okay, and then multiply with the ultimate creep coefficient that you set. All right, in order to get the loss of prestress due to creep. All right, okay. All right, we also have the time function in the case that you want to calculate the loss of prestress due to creep at any specific time. Okay, if you use the former equation, it will mean the creep loss at the end of your service life at time infinity. But in some approach like the time step calculation, okay, or sometimes you want to check it at service condition with specific age of structures, you will need to calculate how much creep occur at that time. Okay, we will just calculate that as CT. CT will be the time function multiplied with ultimate creep coefficient. Okay, and this T, okay, is given, the time function is given as T over 0.6 divided by 10 plus T to the power 0.6 as well. Okay, so if you want the creep coefficient, not at the time infinity, but at, let's say, 1 year, okay, you will need to put 365 in and find the factor. Okay, something like this. Okay, all right. Okay, when you calculate the creep loss, okay, normally the creep at different section will be different. Imagine the member that you have parabolic tendon. Okay, normally at the end, the concrete will have the stress of just P over A. Alright, but at the lower, you have bending effect. So normally you have more compression. Okay, in that case, normally we will not consider and calculate and check the loss due to creep at all location. We will just focus in the location where we have maximum moment. Okay, or where we call the critical section only, and try to check whether the loss of prestress due to creep is within the limit or not, reasonable or not. Right? Mm-hmm. Okay, for the unborn system, okay, as you already know that it is not born. So normally if you want to calculate the loss of prestress due to the creep, you will need to calculate the strain along the span and make the average. Okay, make the average. All right. Okay. Okay. Another note for the creep of concrete is that now, since the creep of concrete due to the load, if there is no load, there will be no loss of prestress due to creep. Okay. And now, actually, the load or the prestressing force change with time. Okay. So this one will be what we call interdependent. Okay, for example, if you have the shrinkage, okay, the loss of prestress due to creep will also depend on how much shrinkage occur in your structure. If you have a lot of shrinkage, the prestressing force will reduce a lot, and when the prestressing force reduce a lot, the actual creep will reduce. Okay, all right, so something like this, okay, will not be taken into account, will not be taken into account when you calculate the detailed approximation. But we will take into account when we use time step calculation, which I will talk briefly at the end of today's presentation. Okay, the last component of the time dependent loss is relaxation of the steels. Okay, the relaxation of the steel is not same with the creep of the concrete. The first difference is that this one is behavior of the steel. Creep is behavior of concrete. Okay, for the creep, it means that you have deformation under constant stress or constant load. Okay, for the relaxation, it means that you have less stress remain under constant deformation. Okay, creep is reduction or the creep is the increase of deformation under constant stress. Relaxation is reduction of the stress under constant deformation. Okay, so the basic idea is that if you have the tendon and then you pull it to get given stress, the elongation should be fixed. Okay, and assume that if the volume of concrete is not changing, okay, let's say that shrinkage is zero, creep is zero, you still have the change, okay, because of the behavior of tendon itself. Okay, and we get very, very basic relationship as shown in this graph. If you put more stress in the tendon, okay, the ratio between the stress and the initial stress that you put in, okay, will become less. I mean, if you put more stress, then the reduction will be faster. It means that if you have the maximum at the initial more, okay, if you put more, okay, the reduction will be even faster. Okay, this one is FPI over FPY. Let's consider this one. This one is mean that you put the stress at the beginning, just 60% of yielding strength of the tendon. In that case, because you put just 60%, you will see that the curve does not drop much. This means that you have less relaxation. But if you put the initial stress in the tendon, okay, equal to 0.9 of yield stress, it means that you almost use all of the capability. You will see very clear drop of the stress in the tendon. Okay, this means that if you put more force, then you get more severe relaxation. Okay, and from this type of curve, we can develop this equation. Okay, this equation obtained from this one. Okay, from this one. And we will use this in the calculation of the loss due to steel relaxation. Okay. Remember that we get the log of time as the function. It means that we are going to represent this curve as the log function. Okay, and under log function, we will divide it by 10. Divide it by 10. Okay. For time step, for example, if you don't want to find only the total relaxation, but if you want to determine the relaxation between two specific time or for the specific period of time. For example, if you want to find how much relaxation occur from 1 year to 5 years, okay, you can just put Tn and Tr, where Tn is 5 years and Tr is 1 year. Okay, Tn is the end of the interval that you are interested, and Tr is the beginning. Okay, but you have to be really careful that the time in this function is the unit of hours, not days. In the calculation of shrinkage, we use day. In the calculation of creep, we also use days. But in the relaxation of the steel, the unit of time will be in hours. In hours. Okay, all right. Another point that you need to make clear is that if you use special type of the steel, for example, the low relaxation steels, okay, the relationship between relaxation and the stress that you put in will be similar to the graph that you just see. Okay, but the relaxation will be less. Okay, so if you remember in the previous slide, the value here will be 10. Okay, but if you use lower, I mean low relaxation still, the relaxation will be reduced. Okay, and the reduction is represented by this factor, 45. So in the calculation, you need to be very sure whether the steel is low relaxation or normal tendon. If it is normal tendon, you use value 10 here. If it is low relaxation, you put 45 here. Okay, and from this equation, you will just get automatically how much stress in the rebar is lost. Okay. All right. This curve show the example of the stress strain relationship of the high strength tendon. Okay, this is the yielding point of normal rebar. You will see that it will be really high, and yielding strength of the tendon or the strain normally given by considering the stress level at 1% deformation. Okay, like this. Okay, all right. Okay, similar to the case of creep. Okay, because the relaxation of the steel occur when there is the force. Okay, so the relaxation of the steels also be interdependent with the shrinkage and creep. Okay, if you have more creep, if you have more shrinkage, the stress will drop very fast and more. Okay, in that case, you have a tendency that you have less relaxation. Okay, so with this, if you want really exact estimation, then you will need to do the time step calculation. Okay, anyway, in some normal, in some case, we will just be able to approximate by putting 0.9 FPI. Okay, you have FPI. If you use FPI in the calculation, you know that it will be overestimated from the actual case. Okay, generally, we can just put 0.9 FPI and calculate the loss due to steel relaxation. Okay, this will give you better approximation of the loss due to the steel relaxation. Okay, so now you already learn about the loss of peak stress due to immediate effect, immediate loss of peak stress. Okay, and also the time dependent loss of peak stress. If you sum all immediate loss of peak stress, then you can determine how much jacking force you need. If you sum all time dependent loss of peak stress, you can calculate how much difference is PE from PI. Okay, from how much effective peak stress is different from PI, and you can check the parameter R. Okay, in the flexural design, you assume value R, either 0.85 or 0.9. Now you can check whether it is same or not. If it is too much different, then you need to revise the design. Okay. Now, if you don't want to calculate one by one each of these, we have also what we call lump sum estimation. Okay, which I already talked in the beginning that for some typical structures, this approach will be used in the practice. Okay, for example, ACE Joint Committee, okay, propose that we can probably use lump sum loss, okay, based on the type of the structure. Okay, for post tension, we may assume that the loss of stress will be equal to 170 MPa. This is the reduction of the stress in the tendon. Okay, for pre-tension, the loss will be 241. Okay, but you need to understand that this value consider elastic shortening, shrinkage, creep, and relaxation. Okay, this value does not include friction loss. Okay, and ankle slip yet. Okay, and because of this, the value in pre-tensioning seem to be a little bit higher. Okay, because in pre-tensioning, okay, you don't have ankle loss. Okay, but you have full elastic shortening. Okay, the value here. The question you may have is that then why don't they just put friction loss and anchorage slip in the value of lump sum? The answer is really simple. They cannot. They cannot because the friction depends on the shape of the tendon. If you have really high curve, you have really high curvature friction loss. Okay. Anchorage slip also depends on the apparatus that you select. If you use the apparatus that have really large gap, then you will suffer more from the anchorage slip. Okay. Because of this, we cannot just put these two in any lump sum approximation. These two must be calculated separately and summed in later based on your apparatus and based on the tendon profile. Alright? Okay. ASTO, okay, the Organization for Highways in US also offer different, okay, lump sum loss of prestress approximation. But this one now depends on the class of the concrete as well as the type of the construction. Okay, I will not go into detail. You can see the different difference is that now they consider the strength of the concrete. But the similar thing is that they don't consider, they don't include friction loss, okay, and anchorage sitting loss in this one yet. All right, okay. PTI Port Tension Institute, okay, also have the guideline for lump sum loss as well, okay. And they separate the loss of prestress in slab and in beam, okay. And also consider the type of tendon that you use. If you use the stress relief normal strand, okay, it will be one value. If you use bar, it will be another one. If you use low relaxation, then it will be minimum one. Okay, all right, just like this. So the concept of lump sum approximation is that you open the guideline, okay, see the tables, then you select the approximate loss of prestress in terms of stress in the tendon. Okay, then you will need to calculate the curve, I mean friction loss at anchorage sitting separately and sum it up. Then you will get loss of prestress. Okay, after that. Alright? Okay. The last topic that we will talk today is what we call time step method. Okay, the need for time step method has been discussed at the beginning. Okay. We have time-dependent loss, and in time-dependent loss, we have creep and steel relaxation that occur because of the force applied on the material for a really long time. Okay, and it is the fact that this force varies with time. Okay, now we know that the force reduces with time. Okay, what we have the tendency that we will apply the initial prestress to calculate the creep loss, okay, or we will use initial prestress to calculate the loss due to steel relaxation. Okay, if we don't use time step, you may intentionally apply some reduction factor like 0.9, okay, in order to make it more reasonable, but we still don't know whether it is really reasonable or not. Okay. In order to make the calculation very, very, very logical, and sometimes you may want to check the number in details, you can just divide the calculation of loss of prestress into time interval. Okay, and there is some guideline. Okay, the guidelines by PCI said that, you can separate the time into steps. The first one can be during the time of casting to the prestressing. Okay, and after that, from the time of prestressing to the age of 30 days after that. Okay, the next step is 30 days until 1 year. Okay, and after that is from 1 year until the end of service life. End of service life means the desired age of the structure. For example, if you are making highway, probably you say that you want to use it for 60 years or 100 years, whatever. Okay, that will be the last step. So what you are going to do is that you just do the detailed calculation, but you consider the time period. You use, for example, for the step number 2, you will calculate the prestressing force that remain after immediate loss. Okay, and then you use that as the initial pre-stress for the period 2. After that, you calculate all loss until the end of 30 days after pre-stressing. Okay, based on all equation that we have discussed. After that, you will get the remaining pre-stressing force at 30 days after pre-stressing. Okay, you use that as the initial pre-stressing for the next time step. And then you calculate the loss of pre-stress for another 1 year. Okay, all right? When you calculate the stress that remains at this 1 year, then you use it again as the initial for the last time step. Okay, then you will get more refined and better approximation of loss of pre-stress. Okay, normally the loss of pre-stress that you obtain from this one will give you a little bit smaller than the details estimation of pre-stress that we discussed today. All right? Okay, this will be all for the loss of pre-stress. Okay, thank you very much.